This is a new day. This has new challenges. It presents us with new opportunities. And we need to have our sights not on what is eroding, not on what is going, not lamenting the change in our society, but having vision and sights on how in this new, unstable era in which we live, is the gospel of Jesus Christ going to be relevant?
And griefs to bear, and what a privilege to carry everything to God in prayer. Oh, what peace we often forfeit. God in prayer. Have we trials and temptations? Is there trouble anywhere? We should never be discouraged. Take it to the Lord.
And I'm paraphrasing, that God knows the plans for you. So don't be afraid. There may be trials, there may be temptations in life, but He cares and He understands, and He has a plan just for you. Jeremiah 29, verse 11.
So do thy friends despise, forsake thee. Take it to the Lord in prayer. Find a soul is there. Take it to the Lord in prayer. Everything to God in prayer.
Join Living Truth as we travel by luxury coach to beautiful Lancaster, Pennsylvania, from May 8th to the 11th, 2017. Your wonderful adventure includes a guided sightseeing tour through Amish country, a steam train ride, a visit to historical Hershey, Pennsylvania, and more. Your visit to Lancaster also includes a live performance of the epic adventure Jonah at the renowned Sight and Sound Theater. The classic Bible story of Jonah springs to life on stage in jaw-dropping scale with spectacular special effects and live animals. You'll also enjoy 3 nights at the beautiful Eden Resort Hotel. Contact us early to reserve your ticket. Call Christian Journeys at 1-877-465-3442 or visit online. Be a part of this wonderful Living Truth experience. See you in Lancaster, May 8th to the 11th, 2017.
What I want to do this morning is speak to you from Ezekiel chapter 22. I'm going to read some verses there. And I want to read you about a burden that God placed on Ezekiel's heart. There's a burden I trust will transfer unto our hearts, into your heart, into my heart, as we consider the great needs of the world. Ezekiel 22, I'm going to read from verse 23. And this is what it says. Again, the word of the Lord came to me, Son of man, say to the land, you are a land that has had no rain or showers in the day of wrath. There is a conspiracy of her princes within her, like a roaring lion, tearing its prey. They devour people, take treasures and precious things, and make many widows within her. Her priests do violence to my law and profane my holy things. They do not distinguish between the holy and the common. They teach that there is no difference between the unclean and the clean. They shut their eyes to the keeping of the Sabbaths so that I am profaned among them. Her officials within her are like wolves, tearing their prey. They shed blood and kill people to make unjust gain. Her prophets whitewash these deeds for them by false visions and lying divinations. They say, this is what the sovereign Lord says, when the Lord has not spoken. The people of the land practice extortion and commit robbery. They oppress the poor and needy and mistreat the alien, denying them justice. I looked for a man among them who would build up the wall and stand before me in the gap on behalf of the land, so I would not have to destroy it. But I found no one. So I will pour out my wrath on them and consume them with my fiery anger, bringing down on their heads all they have done, declares the sovereign Lord. I want to talk to you about three things from this passage. The key I'm going to come back to is going to be that text. I looked for a man among them, that is a person, anybody, who'd be willing to stand in the gap on behalf of the land. So it's through that one person, I would not have to destroy them. But I didn't find one. I want to talk to you about the reasons why they didn't find one. Because there may be the same reasons that are reflected in the fact that many of us are quite prepared to sit on our backside, so to speak. Yes, we believe all this. Yes, we're concerned about all this, but actually not to be available for what God wants to do in us and through us, because God's only strategy in the world is people. He's chosen that. I don't know when you became a Christian, if you're a believer this morning, but I know this, there was some human agency involved. Even if it was reading a scripture, somebody printed it. Maybe it's somebody who's talked to you about Christ. Maybe you heard somebody preach the gospel. But somewhere along the line, God used some human agency to bring in the truth of the gospel. And God is saying, I'm looking for somebody, a man, a woman, a boy, a girl. Doesn't matter who. To stand between me and the people. So I'd not have to destroy them, because I'd have in them an agent through which I could do my work. Now, what I want to do is look in context. That's always important. Scripture is not a selection of verses. It has a story, it's a context. I want to apply that context to our context, our world, today, 2,500 years later. I want to talk first about the conditions of the day. Verse 15, God had said, I will disperse you among the nations and scatter you through the countries, and I'll put an end to your uncleanness. This was his threat, if you like, his promise to his own people in Judah. Because of their godlessness, I will disperse you among the nations, I'll scatter you through the countries. And in Ezekiel's lifetime, the big Babylonian juggernaut was rolling through the Middle East. It was crushing nations and states in its path. It was replacing Assyria, who had been the superpower up until that time, at least immediately before. Egypt had been the superpower before that. And it took 20 years for Assyria, well, the Babylonians rather, Assyrians took the northern kingdom of Israel off into exile, but the Babylonian Empire took 20 years to conquer the land of Judah. They had three prime invasions. The first invasion, they took away the royal family. Some of the aristocracy, amongst them was Daniel. 8 or 9 years later, there was a second invasion of Judah, and they took away all the middle classes. Well, 10,000 of them were numbered and counted that were taken away, leaving basically the poor behind. And Ezekiel was taken away in that second invasion. And then 10 years after that was the final invasion in 586 BC, when the Babylonians reduced Jerusalem to rubble. They destroyed the temple, which was a symbol of Israel's dignity as well as their meeting place with God, and they moved most of the population off into exile. During the second invasion, Ezekiel was taken, and he settled by the Kibar River in faraway Babylon, and for 70 years, the people licked their wounds and tried to adjust to the changing world all around them, a world that was changing politically. Babylon lasted only less than a century. The Persians became the superpower after that. It's changing socially. All the old securities, all the old norms were being swept away. It was changing spiritually. There had been something of a revival in Judah about 24 years before Ezekiel went off into exile, when the days of King Josiah, they're cleaning out the temple and they found covered in dust the book of the law, probably parts of the book of Deuteronomy, and they brought it out. They tried to get back to its teaching. They had what seemed to be like a revival throughout the nation, but it was superficial. It had a form of godliness, but no power. Jeremiah stood up and preached against that seeming revival as being superficial. Now we're separated from Ezekiel's world by 2,500 years, but we too live in a world of incredible change and fast change. There's huge political changes across the world, social changes, spiritual changes, technological changes. In our Western world, the Christian framework on which our constitutions were based are being eroded quickly in Europe since the 5th century, when Constantine was converted. And the state church became common across Europe. And the foundations of people's lives and national structure had some Christian ethic to it. Then later in the 16th century in Northern Europe, with the Reformation, reaffirmed and refined a little bit more the Protestant view. In the New World of North America, it was Puritans who migrated across the Atlantic, and they established nations that also had a Christian basis to them. And when the Canadian Parliament building in Ottawa was constructed, they wrote across the main entrance, Psalm 72, verse 8, "He shall have dominion from sea to sea." That's why Canada is known as a dominion, the dominion of God. That's the original idea from that verse. It's engraved in stone on the Parliament building permanently. But by and large, this thinking is history now. Our world has moved on. Now, it's no good hankering back for the good old days. I hear people doing that. This is a new day. This has new challenges. It presents us with new opportunities. And we need to have our sights not on what is eroding, not on what is going, not lamenting the change in our society, but having vision and sights on how in this new unstable era in which we live, is the gospel of Jesus Christ going to be relevant? You know, when this church was founded in 1928, and the vision of its first pastor, Oswald Smith, having been declined the opportunity to go to the mission field, turned down about six times because of his health, coined a phrase, if you can't go, send a substitute, and he formed the church to have a missionary vision, an outlet. But you know, the missionary challenge in the years since then has multiplied significantly. 1928, the world population was 2 billion. It had reached that number in 1927. By the middle of the century, when I was born, it had reached 2.5 billion people. I remember being in school when the world population passed 3 billion. And I remember in our classroom, we had discussions. Can the world cope with 3 billion people? Does it have enough resources? What is going to happen? And then later that same decade, it passed 4 billion. In 1990, it had doubled in my own lifetime to 5 billion. And today, the world population is 7.3 billion. It has almost tripled in my lifetime. And it's projected to grow another billion if I live a normal life expectancy for someone of my gender and age, will have grown another billion. Currently, the world population rises every year by slightly over 80 million people. That's more than twice the population of Canada. Every year is the increase in population of the world. I have a granddaughter born about 6 months ago. If she lives her full life expectancy, by the end of her life, there'll be 10.8 billion people at the present rate of expansion in our world. How do we envisage this vast population of 7.3 billion? This church began with 2 billion people to reach, now it's multiplied. There's a lady called Donella Meadows, who is an American environmental scientist, and in the 1990s, she first produced what she called the Global Village Report. It was an attempt to describe what the global population was by shrinking it to a village of 100 people, and to describe what the 100 people village would look like. She died in 2001, and there are one or two others who have attempted to update this. And these were as accurate as I can get it. But let me tell you what our world would be like if it was reduced to a village of 100 people. 57 of those villagers would be Asian. I tried to work out what that would mean in this congregation. We're about 1,500 people here this morning. We'll have the same number in the second service. We'll have less in the third service. But just this service of 1,500 people, if we were the whole world population compressed to this number, 855 sitting here this morning would be Asian. Of which 430 would be Chinese. That would be in the population of a village. About 30 would be Chinese. That includes the whole Chinese diaspora. A lot of people in China, a lot of people outside of China too. 17 would be Indian. About 255 in this building would be Indian if we were a shrunken world. 14 would be African. That'd be 210 in this building. 10 would be European. 8 would be Latin American, 5 would be North American, That will be 75 in this congregation this morning. 4 would be Russian, and 2 would be a crazy mix of all the remaining people. And looking at it, you folks, a lot of you would fit into that crazy mix. 2%. Do you know the common language of the village would be Mandarin? Some of us would have to start doing some homework. 17 would have Mandarin as their mother tongue. 9 would speak English. That's actually less than half of the Mandarin speakers in the world. 8 would speak Hindi or Urdu. 6 would speak Spanish, 4 Russian, 4 Arabic. And the remaining 52 would speak Bengali, Portuguese, Indonesian, Japanese, German, French. There's 200 others, I won't mention them all. Those are the big languages. Let me give you the religious profile. 29 of the 100 would identify as Christian. Now, these are the widest possible definition of a Christian. It's those whose affiliation is Christian. Sometimes it's because their parents have them baptized as babies in some Christian church, and so that's how they identify themselves. We heard there are 10 million Christians in Egypt today, and many of those would be nominal. But you know, this number has quadrupled in the last 100 years. The Christian church has quadrupled. The proportion of the Christian church has quadrupled. In the World Christian Encyclopedia, it says Christianity has become the massively accepted religion in the developing world. Of those 29, 23 would be nominal, 6 would take it seriously, and that would include every person who would take, under the broadest banner, Christian, take it seriously. This is not evangelicals, this is Jehovah's Witnesses, this is Mormons, this is the whole bang shoot of those who say, I'm really serious about this. So the slither within that of evangelical Christians would be much smaller. 14 would be Muslims. There's 1.57 billion Muslims in the world at the moment. 13 would be Hindus. 12 would be Buddhists. 8 would be Confucian and Shinto. 5 would be animist, that's traditional folk religion. 1 would be Jewish, and 17 would have no religious allegiance at all. So this village of 100 people would have a lot of churches and a lot of temples and a lot of mosques because and a lot of synagogues because there's so many, well, one synagogue because there's one Jewish person. Do you know that 80 of the 100 would live on less than $10 a day? If we project that onto this congregation this morning, it would mean 1,200 of us would live on less than $10 a day. Within that, 48 of the 100 would live on less than $2 a day, and 20 would live on less than $1 a day. Those are the statistics globally. Meanwhile, 20% would own 80% of the wealth. Health-wise, 12 would be disabled. Now project that onto this congregation, 180 of us would be disabled. That's the proportion if we were a balanced group of people, 180. 15 would be malnourished. 1 would be in the process of dying of starvation of the 100. That's 1% of the world. 13 would have no safe drinking water. That's down from 33 a few years ago. 17 would not be able to read or write. 8 would have access to a computer, which means 92 people wouldn't. You know, if we measure the state of the world by economics, if that was our measurement, if we measured by health, by education, by comfort, by spirituality, we here this morning sit somewhere close to the very top of the pile. Materially, our health system. You're here this morning because you're either a Christian or you're interested in Christianity. So spiritually, you're up near the top. In terms of the peace you've found with God. And there are two ways we can respond to that. We can say, oh, I'm so fortunate. I'm so glad. I hear people go on mission teams, you know, and they come back and they get up here and they say, well, my experience made me so glad to be Canadian. Pathetic. Here's what Jesus said about this in Luke 12:48. From everyone who has been given much, much will be demanded. From the one who has been entrusted with much, much more will be asked. In other words, there are levels of responsibility that grow out of these privileges that God has given to us. That's why we're going to open the window on the world during our Global Outreach Conference, not to say, oh, look at that. Wow, that's interesting. Oh, that's fantastic. Oh, that's a shame, isn't it? Man, that's bad over there. Goodness me. Oh, that's a bright light. That's fantastic. That's good. Very interesting. That's not our purpose. Our purpose is to say, how can we corporately as a church better exercise the privileges God has given us? In ministering and meeting need and going and serving and participating and funding the great opportunities that exist around the world. That's what our purpose is going to be. And, you know, this is just a fact of life. Normally during our Global Outreach Conference, our numbers drop. Make sure you're not one of those drops. People who want to get fat, I want to be nice and spiritually, you know, fat, obese. But don't ask me to be involved. Don't ask me to think hard about my money. And the primary concern of Ezekiel in his day was that all of these material, physical, military situations going on around him, all the oppression, all had a spiritual source. Because he's talking about the people of God, the people of Israel, the people of Judah. And he says that that is where the corruption has begun in verse 26. Her priests do violence to my law and profane my holy things. They do not distinguish between the holy and the common. They teach there's no difference between the unclean and the clean. In other words, it's all become based on relativity. Oh, well, our society doesn't think that's bad. So, you know, we want to be relevant to our society. So let's cut that one. And he brings in those verses a terrible tirade against the spiritual life of the nation. Because they departed from God, everything else about them is corrupted as well. That's the first thing then, the condition of the day. The conditions of Ezekiel's day, the conditions of our day. The second thing I want to talk about is what I'm going to call the call of the hour, because in verse 30, here comes the call. I looked for a man, that is a person, among them who would build up the wall and stand before me in the gap on behalf of the land, so I'd not have to destroy it. But I found no one. Here God is looking. What's he looking for? Is he looking for a new strategy? Is he looking for new methodologies? Is he looking for new tools to get the job done? Is he looking for a new message that is more appropriate, seemingly, in our new society? No, he's looking for a person. E.M. Bounds wrote a book called Power Through Prayer. It's a great book, it's a classic, but his opening line of that book is powerful. He says, men are looking for better methods. God is looking for better men. That's an inclusive use of men there, men and women. This is written over 100 years ago. People are looking for better methods. God is looking for better people. And of course we need our methodologies. Of course we need our strategies. But God's strategy in the world is always people. He doesn't send angels to evangelize. I think I said this a few years ago. It'd be marvelous if he did. You know, the word angel means messenger. And God has got thousands of messengers, thousands of angels. John in the book of Revelation tried to count them once. He said there were 10,000 times 10,000, which is 100 million, plus many more that could not be numbered. I think he did very well numbering the 100 million. But he never sends a single angel to be a missionary. It'd be a lot cheaper, wouldn't it? Wouldn't have to pay airfare. Just flap and go. Wouldn't need feeding. If they get in trouble, no problem. Just disappear at the vital moment. Be a lot more fun if God sent angels to as missionaries, wouldn't it? Be a lot more fun if God sent angels to talk to your neighbors and my neighbors. You know, if we try to talk to our neighbors, we're a little embarrassed, a little tongue-tied, not quite sure what to say, you know, and we know they've heard some things in our house. They've seen the cat come flying out through the upstairs window, you know, and they know we've got our warts and all, you know. And we try to witness, and we feel a little bit embarrassed and self-conscious. Wouldn't it be great if an angel knocked on your neighbor's door, tucked his wings behind his back, said, I've come to talk to you about Jesus, and then to give some credibility, flap his wings and run over. You think they'd sit up and take notice? If we announced that the angel Gabriel would be the speaker at the first Global Outreach Conference Sunday, don't you think we get a good crowd? But he sends people. I look for people. What kind of people is God looking for? Well, I just did a run through the Bible this week thinking about the kinds, the variety of people that God uses. Age, for instance, is not a criteria. Moses was 80 when God sent him to Pharaoh to bring the people of Israel out of Egypt. Abraham was 75 when God told him, look up at the sky, how many stars can you see? He was 75. I'm going to give you a promise now. I'm going to give you as many descendants as the stars you see in the sky. He was 75. It says he was as good as dead. It's not a healthy 75. And it says about Sarah, she was 65, his wife, and she was worn out for some reason. And yet God said, listen, Abraham, yes, he's good as dead. Yeah, I am. I'm waiting to die. I just did my will. Oh, no, no, no. We're just starting, Abraham. Listen, you may be older. And you think, if only when I was younger, I'd made myself available to God. If only I said, Lord, use me. I didn't. I wasted so many years. It is not too late. God uses older people. I was only 30 years younger, 20 years younger, 40 years younger, and I could be used, but it's passed away. No, that's not true. On the other side of the spectrum, Samuel was just a boy. Just a boy when God spoke to him one night, speak, Lord. Well, at least he said, Samuel, Samuel. You remember, Samuel got up and went to Eli the priest. He was staying in Eli's house, and Eli said, go back to bed, you're dreaming. Samuel lay in bed. Samuel, Samuel, you went to the priest. He said, did you call me? No, I didn't. You're dreaming. Go back to bed. Third time, Samuel, Samuel, went to Eli the priest. You should have known better. You're dreaming. But don't come running to me next time. Just stay in your bed and say, speak, Lord, your servant listens. And to Eli's surprise and to Samuel's surprise, God spoke. He was a boy. Mary was a teenage girl when the angel appeared and said, you are highly favored amongst women. And it was the biggest plan in history was implemented through a teenage girl. David was a teenage boy when God got hold of him. Don't say, if you're young this morning, if only I was older, if only I had more experience. No, it's when you're young. That's the most vital time to get involved in saying, Lord, I'm available to you. I want to serve you. Education is not a criteria. Paul was educated at the feet of Gamaliel, one of the most revered teachers in Israel. Moses was educated in all the wisdom of the Egyptians. But the prophet Amos, for instance, had no education at all. He said, I don't deserve to be called a prophet. I was just looked after sycamore trees and a handful of sheep. But God called me. Jesus called uneducated fishermen to be his disciples and to be instrumental in turning the water upside down. If you're educated, great. That gives you a number of advantages. If you're not educated, great. That also gives you some. Our social circumstances are not a criteria. They're members of the aristocracy like Daniel, like some of the kings of Judah, like Queen Esther who came into the kingdom for such a time as this. But they're also peasants, uneducated, the people who looked after sheep like David, looked after sycamore trees like Amos. Your personal strengths and weaknesses are not a barrier. Solomon had a life that seemed altogether, was prosperous, was successful. Hosea, on the other hand, had a life that was falling apart. He had a broken marriage. He had to deal with all the trauma of his broken marriage and his three children. Mary Magdalene had been possessed by seven demons, and yet she became one of the greatest friends of Jesus. Jonah, the man to whom the word of the Lord came a second time. Why? Because first time he ran away in the opposite direction. But he's not written off. The word came a second time. And Jonah, the second time, listen, I don't care who you are. You'll probably find your parallel in the Bible in somebody who's like you. When I was young, I thought God, I knew God would use other people. And did use other people. I honestly did not think he would use me. I honestly did not think that. I knew I could listen to people God was using. I could support people God was using. I could pray for people God was using. I could get behind people God was using. But there are many, many reasons why I felt God cannot use me. But our biggest qualification, you know, is our weakness. I meet someone who says, oh, I can do that. I'm nervous about them. I meet someone who says, I can't do that. But God has called them. I'm excited by them because it'll be God himself working in them and working through them. The more we're aware of our weakness, the more dependent we become on God. And the more we think we can do it, the less dependent we become on God. So I look for a man, a person, someone amongst them. But I found none. The third thing, there was the condition of the day, the call of the hour, now the crisis of the moment I want to talk about, because he says, I looked for a man, but I found none. Therefore, I will pour out my wrath on them. The absence of finding someone was not that God accepted their ignorance as an excuse. Or that they remained outside of his salvation simply. But he is saying that because I couldn't find a man, I don't have access into people's hearts and lives. Earlier in Ezekiel chapter 3 and verse 17, here's a solemn verse where God said, Ezekiel, son of man, I made you a watchman for the house of Israel. So hear the word I speak and give them warning from me. When I say to a wicked man, you will surely die, and you do not warn him or speak to dissuade him from his evil ways in order to save his life, that wicked man will die for his sin, and I will hold you accountable for his blood. But if you warn the wicked man, and he does not turn from his wickedness or from his evil ways, he will die in his sin, but you will have saved yourself. God says our inactivity, our lack of concern means we take the responsibility for those we never served before God. Let me finish quickly with this. Why did God not find a man? A person. Three reasons. And we can take these reasons from this chapter. They didn't care. They didn't share. And they didn't dare. Let me explain that a little bit. They didn't care because back earlier he said in verse 7, in you they've treated father and mother with contempt. In you they've oppressed the alien and mistreated the fatherless and the widow. You have despised my holy things and desecrated my Sabbaths. In you are slanderous men bent on shedding blood. In you are those who eat at the mountain shrines and commit lewd acts. And he's speaking to the princes of Israel when he says that. You are too preoccupied with your own self-interest. You are too in love with your own self-sin. You couldn't care anymore about the needs of others. And these are the people of God he's addressing. They were the princes of Israel. They were the shepherds, if you like, who earlier in chapter 34 and verse 4, he says, you've not strengthened the weak, you've not healed the sick, you've not bound up the injured, you've not brought back the strays, you've not searched for the lost. You are only concerned about yourself. They didn't care. You know, the motivation for serving God is not that we've got the techniques worked out, it's love. Knowing we're loved by God, first of all, that's the first essential. And out of that love, we love others because he first loved us. We love him, but we love others. That flows out of that. They didn't care. Second is they didn't share. Because it said back in verse 12 of this chapter, in you men accept bribes to shed blood. You take usury and excessive interest. You make unjust gain for your neighbors by extortion, etc. He said, you're just ripping the people off all the time. Instead of sharing what you have, instead of sharing your resources, you are squeezing everything out of people. Here it was in their power to bring relief, to bring justice, to bring freedom. Instead, they brought oppression and extortion. They're described as being greedy, taking bribes, charging excessive interest, getting unjust gain from the neighbors, being guilty of extortion, of robbing, of oppressing the poor, of mistreating the alien, of denying them justice. This is all totally self-centered living. And these were the people of God. They didn't care. They didn't share. And thirdly, they didn't dare, because when God said, I looked for a person who would stand before me in the gap, that would take courage. It takes courage to stand out in our world and be different. One of our prayers for the Global Outreach Conference this year is that many of us will open our hearts courageously and say, God, what will you have me to do personally? What is your role in my life? I'm not telling you that you go to the mission field. That's God's prerogative to tell you that. The day of overseas missionary is not over, by the way. We're going to be commissioning two couples during our Global Outreach Conference, two couples from this church, one to go to Asia, one to go to North Africa. Two couples going to serve God overseas, and they're going to go out on our behalf. We got to get behind them in prayer and support. God will call some overseas, some at home, some full-time, some part-time, some long-term, some short-term. The question is, are you asking him what it is that you would do? That's our prayer that some of us would. And other prayers all of us can give, because you see, we don't like talking about money, but you cannot do anything without money. It's an utter fact of life. We as a church are privileged to support the Alexandria Bookshop in Egypt. We're involved in many other projects around the world. You folks are incredibly generous. We give several million dollars away every year into mission work around the world. But not everybody participates in that. All of us could. The one who gave the most in the New Testament, according to Jesus, was the lady who gave two mites. Jesus said to his disciples, this lady has given more than them all, because her spirit was behind the little she had. as you gave it sacrificially. You say, well, I can't do very much. The answer is actually that you can. Finish with this story of a boy who was walking along a beach with his father after a big storm had brought in an unusually high tide that had swamped up over the beach, and there were hundreds and hundreds of starfish that had been swept onto the sand. And the tide had gone out, leaving them high and dry. It was unlikely another high tide would come and sweep them back into the ocean before most of them would dry up and die. And as they walked along, the father explained to his son why there were so many starfish. He bent over, picked one up, and he threw it into the sea. He then picked up another one, threw it into the sea. And his father said, you don't need to do that. There are far too many. It's not worth it. And the boy said to his dad, as he threw a starfish into the sea, it was worth it for that one, Dad. We don't want to get big, grandiose ideas about changing the world. That'll discourage us and depress us. But let's get compassionate about changing someone. I looked for a man, a woman, a boy, a girl, a young person, older person, middle-aged person, it doesn't matter. I looked for someone among them who would build up the wall and stand before me in the gap on behalf of the land. But I found none. None. So nothing happened. Do you care enough? Will you share enough? Will we dare enough and be God's people in this incredibly needy world? Let's pray together. Father, we are so grateful this morning that we're not in a waiting room here, passing time until one day we arrive in heaven. But we are living in your workshop. We are your instruments. We are your agents. And I pray, Lord Jesus, that you begin to create in our hearts a fresh appetite, a fresh desire, a fresh longing. So not only see you at work in our world, that we have deep compassion for our world. But we dare to ask the question, what do you want me to do? And we dare to listen for the answer. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Do you know someone who would benefit from this message? Share it through our website, livingtruth.ca. And while you're online, join the discussion about this week's message and follow the links to our Facebook page and YouTube channel.
Join us next week for a special Easter message from Charles Price on Living Truth.
Desert in a Bedouin tent in a seemingly bleak and lifeless landscape. And I'm reminded of a special Dutch friend of mine and some of the stories he's told me. I've known Johan for almost 30 years and I've always been fascinated when he recalled his years in the Sinai Desert living amongst the Bedouin. He left home and he set off on the popular hippie trail through the desert from India to Israel. Embarked on by many young people in the 1960s who were looking for the meaning of life. The nomadic lifestyle of the Bedouin appealed to Johan, so he settled down to live amongst them for a while. How did you survive, I asked him. What did you eat? Where did you find water? There seems to be nothing here in the desert. That's where you're wrong, he told me. And then he illustrated his point with a very funny little story I've never forgotten, and it's always encouraged me when I felt like giving up. I used to live in a little tent, Johan recalled, and every morning I'd walk about 20 paces from the tent and relieve myself in the same place in the sand. I realized this gives streams in the desert a whole new meaning. After 2 years, Johan explained with a glint in his eye, a plant grew. I laughed and I couldn't resist asking him, was it a sweet pea? Why do I tell you this story? Because it's fun, but also it contains an amazing spiritual truth. Just because you can't see something happening in someone's life or in an area you've gone to live in, it doesn't mean there's nothing happening. Seeds may well have been sown, and you may know nothing about what's going on. But if you just keep watering, Johan would say, one day a plant will bloom. Not only is there water to be found in the desert, some of the plants that do manage to grow there have put down 30-foot roots to draw on. But there's also water to be shared. As Johan told me, the Bedouin have a saying, there's only one thing worse than murder in the desert. It's if you know where the water is and you don't tell someone who is passing. Apparently, 2 days in the summer without water in the desert and you're dead. When you've drunk the living water, the Lord Jesus himself, you're not to keep him to yourself. You're to share him. As Jesus told the woman he met at a well in Samaria, whoever drinks the water I give him will never thirst. Indeed, the water I give him will become in him a spring of water welling up to eternal life. John 4:14. The world has many things to offer thirsty people, but they never satisfy. As Jesus said, anyone who drinks this water, the literal material, they'll be thirsty again. If you know where the water is, and you don't tell the person who's thirsty, who's passing by, the Bedouin say, you're as good as giving them the death sentence. The Bedouin are known to be some of the most hospitable people in the world, and we've experienced that this evening. They share all of what they have. It's wonderful to be amongst them and have been offered tea. The Bedouin always leave people things on their way through the desert, through life. They lead food and matches and wood in trees so that people can find them and they can cook. They do this for practical reasons, knowing how impossible it is to survive in the desert without supplies. But they also share for soul reasons, thank you, to say to other people, you are not alone in the world. He who has the Son has life. He who does not have the Son does not have life. If you have received Jesus, you have life to offer to the person who does not, who you meet along the way, to offer him living water for sustenance, to welcome him into your tent for shelter. A king will reign in righteousness and rulers will rule with justice. Each man will be like a shelter from the wind and a refuge from the storm, like streams of water in the desert, and the shadow of a great rock in a thirsty land, Isaiah 32, verse 2. Does that describe you?
Shackled by a heavy burden, beneath a load of guilt and shame, then the hand of Jesus touched me, and now I am no longer the same. He touched me, oh, he touched me. Something happened, and now I know and made me whole. Since I met this blessed Savior, and since He cleansed and made me whole, oh, I will never cease to praise Him. I'll shout it while eternity rolls. He touched me, oh, He touched me, and oh, all the joy that floods my soul. You see something happened